Morning. Welcome to our virtual church service at Covenant Church in Arlington, Massachusetts. This is our sermon, and our scripture passage for today will be Matthew 25, 31 through 46. Yes, it's a little bit long, but it's a very important passage, I think, for us at a time like this. So please read along with me as I read aloud. Matthew 25, 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will all go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Let's pray for our sermon today. Almighty Father, I pray that you would speak through me your words of truth and goodness. And I pray for us that you would give us ears to hear and hearts to receive and even to live those words. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So, as I said before, welcome to our first online sermon at Covenant Church. Let's start with this. We have a fork in the road today. On the one hand, there are some faithful Christians who say that we should not let our worship be dictated by coronavirus. So we should do things like continue on with our regular sermon series during Lent on the seven last words of Jesus from the cross. We've only gotten through the first two, and this is the fourth Sunday of Lent. On the other hand, there are other faithful Christians who say that because Jesus must inform everything we do, and all the ways that we think, we must submit this historical moment, all of our anxieties, to God through his word and prayer. And so it's important, for example, to have a sermon teaching how we live faithfully in a time like this. You can probably imagine how I come out on this. I've shared before in the context of prayer that it's always deeply bothered me when churches I have attended feel bound to the script and must stick with the schedule instead of opening their eyes and looking around and praying for the world we inhabit at this moment I think the same is true for sermons. So the title of this sermon is Living Faithfully in a Pandemic. On Facebook last week, I saw a photograph someone had taken of a handwritten letter that a pastor somewhere had left for his or her congregation. It read as follows. Since I've not pastored people through a pandemic before, I don't know all the answers, but I'm paying attention to science and praying for wisdom. Together, we will take courage, be patient, consider the least of these, and press onward while loving our neighbors. Love your pastor. P.S. Wash your hands. We have started with a Facebook quotation and a virtual sermon. All of a sudden, our church is very, very different. I apologize for that. I wish I'd written that letter because I too feel the burden of having never been a pastor through a pandemic. But there are faithful Christians who have. And so what we are going to do today is engage the theological insights and specific advice of one of those Christians, Martin Luther. Let me be clear, what Luther says does not have the same authority for us as Scripture does. So I'm not simply going to summarize what Luther says. Instead, I'm going to engage his arguments and his thoughts as someone who might have some real wisdom for us. We're going to engage with Scripture throughout today. We are going to turn to Luther for guidance on what passages might be most relevant for us and on how we might think about them in this time. So here's our outline for today. We'll talk about the strong and the weak, then a word for the strong, and a word for the weak. Let me set some context first. In the early 16th century, a little less than 200 years after the bubonic plague, which became known as the Black Death, ravaged the world and killed half the population of Europe, the plague reemerged in Luther's own city and in the surrounding towns. A doctor named Johann Hess wrote a letter to Luther asking him whether it's proper for a Christian to run away from a deadly plague. It seems over the course of several months, Luther composed his reply and he sent it anticipating that it would be shared broadly. So let's talk about the strong and the weak. This is a distinction that Luther gets from the Apostle Paul. So in Romans chapter 14, first verse there, we read, "Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions." And then Paul goes on to talk in that chapter and early in the next about what makes one weak and strong in faith. He will say in Romans 15:1, "We who are strong ought to put up with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves." So it's clear that Paul considers himself one of the group that he calls the strong. It's not entirely clear what's going on in the Roman church with this distinction, but it seems fairly reasonably clear. Those who are strong are those who feel that it's okay to eat meat, those who feel that it's okay to drink wine, and those who don't feel bound to celebrate certain times as sacred. While the weak are those who feel that they must only eat vegetables, can't drink wine, and must celebrate certain sacred times. Whatever may be the background here of Jewish, Gentile, parts of the church, or some other possibility, what's important for our purpose today is this phrase, weak in faith. So in some way, Paul seems to be suggesting that there's something quantitatively or qualitatively about the faith of the weak that makes them weak. They're somehow immature, somehow not able to act as boldly as Paul himself and the strong do. We could say it this way: whether one is strong or weak in faith allows one or prohibits one from acting in certain ways. So Luther picks up this distinction and he applies it to living through the plague. In his context, what he says is those who are strong in faith are those who feel they can stay, not flee, go out, help their neighbors, trust that God will protect and provide. While those who are weak in faith in this context are those who are scared, more fearful of the plague, and more inclined to preserve their own life. What's interesting, and I think revealing for us, is that Luther allows for both the strong and the weak. He will exhort both. We'll talk about that in a minute. But he doesn't condemn either one of them. And in different ways, he exhorts and affirms both of them. But it's not as simple as Luther saying, "Hey, people who are weak, be weak. People who are strong, be strong." Instead, he takes people where they are and offers them specific theological insight and advice for where they find themselves. And I think this is really wise for us to pick up and apply to our situation. There are, I know, some of us who are more fearful, who are more inclined to stay in the house, who are more worried about going to the grocery store for themselves or for others. And there are others among us who are more bold, who feel that in faith they can step out and they can help more broadly in outside of doors. I think it's important that we recognize what Paul recognized and what Luther recognized, which is that the strong should not judge and condemn and look down on the weak. In fact, and vice versa, and vice versa. In fact, I think what's critical to acknowledge is that God is gracious to all of us at this moment. And God wants to take us and work with us each as he finds us, not as we're supposed to be or should be or will be 5 or 10 years from now, but he wants to push and comfort and exhort each person where they're at in their faith. The second thing that is important to recognize with this distinction is that Luther offers, and I'm going to offer, a specific message tailored to each group. So first, what is Luther's word for the strong? And what does he base this on in Scripture? Is it useful and relevant and right for us in our context? To the strong, who again are the people who are more bold, more able to step out, less fearful, more able to help, Luther says you have to avoid something he calls the sin on the right hand. Honestly, I'm not sure exactly why he calls it that, but here's what he's talking about. He says, "Look, it's good and right to seek to preserve your own life." He cites Ephesians 5:29 through 30. where Paul writes, "For no one ever hates his own body, but he nourishes and tenderly cares for it, just as Christ does for the church, because we are members of his body." You see the point. I mean, there's a claim, Luther says, in Scripture that you are not to hate your body, you're to care for your body. And there are, he points out, a good number of examples, a lot of examples in Scripture of people fleeing from danger to preserve their life. So he mentions Jacob, who flees from Esau, or Moses, who flees to the land of Midian, or David, who flees from Saul and Absalom and others. And Luther says, look, I mean, Scripture says, I mean, it seems to be fine that these people are preserving their own lives. He turns to common sense and says, look, if you run out of a burning house, or if you're stuck in deep water and you swim out of that, or if it's freezing outside in the winter and you go inside to be by the fire, or if you seek medical care when you're injured or sick, or if you just eat and drink instead of starving, aren't you revealing a God-given impulse to flee from death? So he says to the strong, don't be reckless. Take care of yourself. Take care of your body. Be smart. I would add this. One of the most important verses in Scripture, according to Jesus, is Leviticus 19:18. The second part of that verse reads, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Here's what I want to point out to you. This fits with the argument from Scripture that Luther's making. There's two people that Leviticus 19:18 is having you love. Not just your neighbor, also yourself. You're to love yourself and your neighbor as yourself. So what Luther calls sin on the right hand is people that are strong in faith, but are not being smart during a time of plague. And he doesn't mince words. He exhorts in very strong terms. He says, if you're not careful to avoid this temptation of being reckless and rash, you risk being a mass murderer. So just because you don't fear death and you have a heart for your neighbor doesn't mean you won't end up doing your neighbor great, great damage. And at this point, Luther gives some practical advice. And if I am reading him correctly, may actually be arguing for social distancing. And he says, first, people should use medicine. Second, they should fumigate their house, yard, and street. I don't know enough about the historical context to offer any insight into that other than to say, please don't go fumigate anything, all right? Disinfect. There's your modern day analogy. Third, Luther writes this. He says, I shall avoid places and persons where my presence is not needed, in order not to become contaminated and thus perchance infect and pollute others and so cause their death as a result of my negligence. I think this is a great word for us. Again, grounded in a deep reading of Scripture and how God would have us be in the world. I think it's a word for us in two ways. First, and candidly, I want to say to some of you, please take this more seriously. It's not godly not to. In fact, it's unloving. I have created a resources page on our website. I'm really excited about this, actually. The first set of resources are the articles that I've found useful that other Christians are writing, thinking through things like I'm thinking through today, what it means to live faithfully in a time of plague as a Christian. The second set of resources are things like I'm preaching on today. What have Christians historically who have lived through epidemics written and said and preached? And I have on there not just Luther's letter, but also my summary of it that digests it and makes it a little easier to understand. And the third set of resources is I am gathering the list of reputable sources talking about the coronavirus, its dangers, its symptoms, who's high risk. So, sources like the CDC or NPR, it's critical that we trust reputable sources and rely on them. So, please look on there. And I think Luther's word is right. We have to take care of ourselves, and there is nothing wrong with that. And there's a lot right with that. The second reason why I think this is a good word is that even the strong in faith have to be smart about how we help one another. So today, I went to the grocery store to buy some groceries for one of you who is at higher risk. And when I went to drop those off, I didn't go inside the apartment. I didn't go inside the apartment building. I called, he came down, I put the groceries on the ground, I backed away, my 6 feet away. And, we can kind of chuckle, but we shouldn't. I think it's great to be smart. And that's what Luther is admonishing us to do. Here's a better example. There's an article that I read by a pastor named Stephen Coe, who this appeared in Christianity Today. I don't think I put this up on the website yet, but I will. He's a pastor who used to work for Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. He was a medical officer and a global health professor. And he tells the story of CDC folks that went to help and care for and work with people during an Ebola virus epidemic. And he says, look, we don't need to be afraid. Just like Jesus, we can serve and love and heal. But those folks put on a lot of protective gear. It would take hours to put on all the gear that they had to put on to help and tend to the patients with Ebola. He says the patients weren't able to be touched by their friends and relatives, but they deeply appreciated the doctors and nurses who would touch them even through protective gear. It was the last touch many of them ever received. All right, what about a word for the week? What does Luther say about that? Is he right? And does it apply to us? If the strong are tempted towards what Luther calls sin on the right hand, the weak are tempted towards what he calls sin on the left hand. Again, I don't really understand this terminology, but basically, here's the idea. Those who are weak in faith because of fear are tempted to fail to serve and help and love. And Luther says, look, we can't abandon our roles and duties and obligations. If you are a pastor, you have to lay your life down for your sheep. That's John 10:11. And continue to provide the word and provide the sacraments. And if you're in public office, like a mayor or a judge, or if you're a doctor, you can't abandon your post and your people. And if you're a parent, you can't abandon your child. And if you're a child, you can't abandon your parent. And Luther grounds these obligations in different passages of Scripture. Now, he is, I want to be clear. I want to be clear. He is more flexible than you might think. He said, look, if you're a pastor, you can flee. There are certain conditions, okay? If there are enough other pastors to perform the duties that need to be performed, and if you're fleeing only because you don't want to expose yourself needlessly, and if you're willing to stay if necessary, you're okay to flee. And he says, if you're in public office, if there are capable substitutes for your role, and you can continually and carefully supervise them, you can also flee, and so on and so forth. There is one category of obligation we haven't talked about yet, and I think this is where Luther is at his most challenging. And that's what we really need to reckon with for us. That's the duty toward our neighbor. We can't abandon our neighbor, and we even have to sometimes put our life at risk caring for our neighbor. Luther relies on two passages from Scripture to deal with this. The first is Matthew 7:12, which reads, "In everything, do to others as you would have them do to you, for this is the law and the prophets." And the second is the parable of the sheep and goats with which we started. And one of the things that the sheep do that the goats don't is care for and visit the sick. And when they do that, they're caring for and visiting Jesus himself. Luther's reading of these two passages is not sophisticated. It's very simple, and it's almost certainly right. With regard to Matthew 7:12, basically argues, don't you want someone to care for you when you're sick and not abandon you? And with regard to the parable of the sheep and the goats, he basically argues, doesn't this involve caring for the sick? So we may have to be wise and discerning and careful, but don't we have to love our neighbor to follow Jesus? He puts it this way: if it were Jesus himself or his mother Mary that were sick and needed tending to, wouldn't you do it? Isn't that exactly what the parable is saying? He writes this: if you wish to serve Christ and to wait on him very well, you have your sick neighbor close at hand. Go to him and serve him, and you will surely find Christ in him, not outwardly, but in his word. If you do not wish or care to serve your neighbor, you can be sure that if Christ lay there instead, you would not do so either, and you would let him lie there. Luther goes on to cite another passage from Scripture, 1 John 3:15 through 17, which reads like this: all who hate a brother or sister are murderers, and you know that murderers do not have eternal life abiding in them. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Like Luther's word for the strong in faith, this word for the weak in faith, I believe, is a word for us, a word from Scripture. Historians have written about how it seems to be clear that a major, major reason that Christianity spread like wildfire throughout the Roman Empire is that Christians cared for the sick during times of plague. Now, let me be clear. I'm not saying that we have to care for the sick for instrumental reasons or as some sort of evangelism strategy. I'm simply saying that when we care for the sick, somehow in some mysterious way, we're caring for Jesus. And in doing that, we're displaying the heart of Jesus for the world. And people will find that inescapably beautiful. Brothers and sisters, we have to lay down our lives for one another, and it will involve, at points, incurring some risk. Those of us who are at lower risk have to help get groceries and medicine and essentials for those of us who are higher risk, and not just for those who are in our church. This is a time where, like Jesus talks about in the parable of the Good Samaritan, we have to open our eyes and look around us and ask and realize who our neighbor really is. And it's not just those within our walls. And I think we absolutely have to be pressured by the Word of God to be more generous at a time when we are financially worried, to be more generous than we're comfortable with at a time that we are more anxious than we've been, because we're being generous to Jesus himself. See, what we're talking about today is the heart of the Christian faith. Do we want to pick up our cross and follow Jesus? Can we seek and trust the voice of the Holy Spirit to know how to act wisely? Who should go out? When? How often? How can they do that efficiently to protect themselves and care for others? Will we let others serve us? Can we receive as well as give? Do we really have the faith that we thought we had 2 or 3 weeks ago? See, as a pastor, it's terrifying for me to say these things. I'd rather just somehow, in some way, tell you all to stay inside or just to help other people within the church that you're close to and friends with and love already. But I have to preach the word of God, whether that's hard or easy. And I have to preach it, even if it could prompt and lead to faithfulness that leads to sickness or even death. I want to end today's sermon with this quotation from Martin Luther. The plague will test our faith and love. Our faith in that we may see and experience how we should act toward God. Our love in that we may recognize how we should act toward our neighbor. Amen.